This is Ham Radio Now, episode 318. I had to check. Can't remember for 3 seconds. And the title of this one, oh, by the way, this is Ham Radio Now, the most important ham radio program on the internet. So there, everybody else.
Yes, we are. There you go. Marty's going to start challenges singing on that one.
Anybody's welcome.
He's not doing TVs, so it's okay.
Yeah, well, I just say program because, you know, we're our audio audience is approaching the same size as the video audience.
You got a title for us?
Oh, yeah. Episode 318, Home on the Range. You got a harmonica?
Excellent. Not within arm's reach.
All right.
I bet I could materialize one from the house somewhere, but not in the amount of time you want me to.
And that is a little bit too vague, so we'll make it home on the antenna range. And so last Friday, I was down in Charlotte, North Carolina. Charlotte wants everyone to think that they're a big enough city that you don't have to say what the state is. They had an advertising campaign a few years ago that they called it Charlotte, USA. Out there in about as far as you can get from Charlotte, do you know where Charlotte is?
I know it's in North Carolina.
Okay, that's good enough. I mean, just to know it exists. How about Raleigh?
I think that's in North Carolina, too.
Denver?
Denver's in Colorado. I've been to Denver. I don't think I've been to Charlotte or Raleigh. I may have flown in and out of Raleigh at some point.
New York City. We're just testing your geography.
New York City. Yeah. I'll have to work on that one. Come back to me later.
Des Moines.
Des Moines is Iowa.
Pretty good. Raleigh's bigger than Des Moines.
There you go. You think from in Raleigh, they can get from Raleigh to Des Moines with on single sideband?
Well, as we said in the previous episode, can you get us in Iowa?
We hear you, but we don't get you.
Yes, that's like for that. Sure.
Should I do the Marty thing again?
Do the Marty thing again.
Marty, have you got your homework done?
Oh, poor Marty. He's never coming back.
Oh yeah, I just talked to him a few minutes ago. We're getting our dates and things straightened out. So this episode is all about VHF and UHF stuff that isn't FM. What did we kill?
No, I killed something over here. Oh,
but suddenly, your picture got really good, and then
I was trying to. So I realized that I wasn't wired, and I thought, well, that was stupid. So I tried to wire, and when I turned the Wi-Fi off, it dumped me.
You're total. No, you're back. It finally figured out what you were. The bandwidth is worse than ever, but.
Well, I turned the Wi-Fi back on. I'm going to try that one more time. Okay. Actually, no, I won't. Should I? Yeah. I'm going to try one more time.
Make critical changes in the middle of a interesting program.
Yeah. I probably shouldn't have done that.
Because what could possibly go wrong?
It connected to my fast Wi-Fi. I almost think I should just leave it this way and we should move forward. Because you were actually ping-ponging before. But now you're clear. Life.
Okay.
So what were you talking about?
We're talking about VHF, UHF, and above that is not FM.
It is not FM.
Did you know that such a thing exists?
I do. We actually, our Aries group, we have once a month on one of the alternate Mondays, we do our regular net on the FM repeaters. And then we always have a secondary simplex net. And one of the weeks during the month, we do 2 meter single sideband.
Do you
which
have,
I can't do.
I was going to ask, do you have equipment that would do,
no,
that
would do such? Sadly.
Actually,
I had an ICOM rig, an old ICOM model rig that would do it. But one of my kids helped me clean up the garage and it took a 4 foot drop and no longer.
Oh,
yeah.
Because there are actually a fair number of radios that do the VHF or HF. I mean, they're all HF radios. Yep. And then they add, a lot of them add 6 meters and right. A few of them add 2 meters and a few less add 70 centimeters. A radio like this one up there on the shelf. Well, it's, you can see it on the shelf behind me sitting under Arvin. It's Arvin's prop up thing. That's an old, ICOM 706 Mark II G. That's a really good radio. And it's almost hard to believe that it is now two generations obsolete.
Yeah.
Its replacement, the 7000, is also obsolete, at least discontinued. Not, maybe not obsolete, but discontinued. So, such of those things exist, and you can operate single sideband on 2 meters and on 70 centimeters in addition to FM. And there is some of that stuff out there. And there are groups of people, of hams, that are very much dedicated to operating those modes. I'll tell you what, we talk about that some in the episode. What I did was recorded an interview in Charlotte with Al, let me get your name right, Al Tirevold, WA0HQQ, another out-of-call area ham, because he lives in Georgia. Mm-hmm. But he's a zero. And he was running the antenna range. They were doing some antenna testing. And that's one of the popular things that they do at these VHF conferences. And there are a bunch of these VHF outfits around the country. This one was the Southeastern VHF Society. And as you can see, the conference was 5 days ago. And here is Al at the antenna range. Antenna range guy, and they did a bunch of other things, and we actually talk about that in the interview. So, you know, rather than you and me discussing what is about to be played in the interview, why don't I just boot that up, and we'll take a look at it.
We'll
roll it,
and we'll discuss it after.
Yeah, so this is about 30 minutes worth. We'll see if I can crash Wirecast and Facebook Live and everything else, and then we'll give it a try. I've got a switch full screen there, and it is theoretically going to take over your picture.
All right.
In a moment.
Who are you?
Oh, I'm Al Tirevold. My call is WA0HQQ.
All right. Well, start broad. What is this big event?
It's an annual conference for ham radio operators, amateur radio operators, who specialize in VHF and UHF operation, which is above 30 megahertz generally.
Okay. So our audience out there watching the TV show, the Ham Radio Now TV show, is hams in general.
Uh-huh.
Their impression of VHF is 2 meter repeaters.
Right.
Maybe if they're, you know, really esoteric about it, they'll get on 70 centimeters.
Right.
440. Apparently something else happens in those bands besides FM.
Yes, the folks that are at this conference regularly hold contacts that are cover hundreds of miles at VHF frequencies on a regular basis.
Through linked repeaters?
No. This is direct.
I'm baiting you here.
But using average amounts of power of 100 watts, 50 watts, 100 watts. As you saw, the some of the antennas are fairly high gain antennas, so there's some specialty involved there.
Okay, so the antennas will be bigger than a rubber duck.
Yes, they'll be bigger than a rubber duck.
And typically up as high as you can get them.
Usually, yes.
Most of these guys will have a tower.
Right. And most of them, the objective is to get above the tree line because the foliage will attenuate the signal. So that gives them an even better signal.
Okay, so 2 meters, 220, 440,
220, 440,
even 1200. How far can they talk?
Hundreds of miles.
All day, every day?
Not all day, every day, but certain times of the day. There are folks here that hold regular schedules over a wide area that covers 100, 200 miles nearly every day using single sideband. And the folks that use the weak signal modes, JT65 and the narrow band type modes do even better than that because they can operate below the noise level. And so what these folks do is a step above repeaters. It goes far beyond that. It goes to the point where it's HF operators would have difficulty covering some of these distances at some HF frequencies during a day.
This is a real niche operation, isn't it?
It can be a niche. There aren't that many folks. They're dedicated. At one time, most of the equipment was homebrewed, although there's a lot of commercial gear available now. Nowadays, you can buy commercial gear that covers 6 meters and even 2 meters fairly readily.
And even, you know, like the ICOM 7000s and 7100s that, are the 70 centimeter sideband.
They'll do that.
So I was going to ask, are those real radios on those bands?
They are.
Sideband?
They are real radios. They're less than optimums. These folks are used to working with very, very sensitive receivers and preamps that have been optimized for that band. And the radios that they use an ICOM for is the IF radio. It's used for the intermediate frequency rather than as the actual transmitter and receiver.
And what band will they typically use for that?
28 megahertz, 10 meters.
Yeah. And okay, so a converter goes in front of that.
Correct.
To take 2 meters, 440, 1200, 2400.
And bring it down into typically 28 megahertz. Yeah. Some of them use 2 meters as an IF.
Yeah. And the gain, the sensitivity, the capabilities of that system go well beyond what you could get out of a 706, 7000, 7100.
Yeah, they're approaching the physical limit of the medium. I mean, they're to the point where you're pushing the technology right down to the edge of what it's capable of doing. And the folks inside that are doing the noise testing on preamplifiers are actually building, and the preamps that are in there are being built to provide that super high performance, low noise performance up at UHF, VHF, up clear into microwaves.
So these guys have some pretty good technical chops.
Very much. At one time they had to homebrew it all, and now there's a lot of it that's available commercially. The one that a lot of folks use is Down East Microwave in Florida. They make a lot of equipment for these bands. They specialize in that stuff. And the owner's here today. And so you'll be able to look at some of his equipment here and talk to him about how he does it and why he does it and what its capabilities are.
All right. When did you get into this? How far back do you go? Because I got a story.
With this group?
But in VHF.
In VHF?
In ham radio period.
Ham radio period goes back 54 years.
Okay. So you got me by 2 years. I'm only 52 years. There, people out there are not going to understand this, but there was a time when there was nothing on 2 meters and even less on 70 centimeters.
Oh, very much. Very much.
No
repeaters. There was no repeaters.
Yeah. And we're talking early 60s, late 50s, almost up to 1970.
Right. And one of the things that happened in the, I guess it was the early 60s when they put Echo 1 up. Remember the big Mylar balloon that they orbited, that NASA orbited?
Barely.
And basically it was used as a reflector. And there were some hams that said, it's up there. Let's see what we can
do
with it.
How high did
it go? It was in orbit. It was 100 miles up.
Okay.
Or 150 miles,
orbited
whatever.
The whole planet?
Right. And
it was a balloon.
It was a balloon, basically a big Mylar balloon. And I was like, I don't know, 10 or 12 years old and standing in the middle of a plowed field in Iowa watching it come above the horizon.
So you could see it?
I could see it. And
in daytime?
This was in the evening.
Okay.
At sunset, just after sunset.
Okay, so it was in sunlight. You were
It was in
more
sunlight.
Like in dark.
I was in the darkness, and you could see it for a
like
little while.
Like you could
while.
See satellites today,
right? And that was used by hams at that time who had an entrepreneurial spirit. They tried make contacts via it, and I don't know remember if they succeeded, but I remember the attempts. But my interest in VHF didn't. I got into it commercially. I got a commercial radio license and put in commercial systems, but as a ham, I didn't get into it until 15 years ago.
Commercial systems
being
FM.
FM, point to point,
digital
systems, law enforcement, public safety.
Okay, so you weren't doing the 2 meter stuff back in the 60s when you first got on. Okay, so see, I was.
I
started with a Heathkit tour.
Yeah, on AM.
On AM, yeah.
Right.
And in Chicago. And there was a cadre of dedicated people, mostly technicians, because that's all they could do, is 6 meters and 2 meters, that populated a small slice of the 2 meter band, somewhere around 145 megahertz. 145.3 was high back then. And in 1965, I think there might have been one repeater in Chicago, one very early.
In Minneapolis, there was one, and my friend up there showed me his mobile rig, and it was this monstrous Motorola commercial two-way unit. Had tubes in it.
Yeah.
It sat in his trunk in the back of his car. Had a dynamotor on it.
Yep.
And that was what he used. And of course, he was using a crude repeater at that time. And it was interesting to me, but being from out on the prairie. Central Nebraska, it was a little hard to find a repeater.
Nobody was going to put one out there.
Yeah, there were no repeaters.
And so we had this, and these radios, there, you know, Heathkit made one, Lafayette, Hallicrafters. They were typically about 5 or 10 watts. They were AM, mm-hmm. and maybe crystal controlled. If you had a fancy one, you might have a VFO. Mm-hmm. But then there were also these guys doing what you're doing today, the guys running sideband.
Mm-hmm.
And those guys, a typical station, in my estimation, would be a kilowatt, 100-foot tower, and stacked, probably four stacked 10, 12-element beams.
Mm-hmm.
And so that exists today. It's just nobody knows about it. Well, it's a column in QST that nobody reads, except for you guys.
Yeah. That got to be expensive, trying to get all that fabricated. And, of course, they used a lot of cavity-type technology to build with and that type of thing, which was difficult to do. You had to be a sheet metal expert in addition to everything else in order to get a lot of the UHF stuff to even work.
So this group here, the Southeast VHF Society, meets, well, once a year?
Once a year.
And around the Southeast?
Somewhere in the Southeast. Florida, Georgia, the Carolinas.
And today we're in Charlotte.
Today we're in Charlotte. Last year there was a, they call a super conference, where three VHF groups got together and put a conference on. It was in Virginia, which was the center of all three groups. So every few years they get together for a super conference.
There's forums and learning. Is there any new technology?
What's amazing is most years you'll see some pretty interesting technology come up that gets presented that's right up on the leading edge or the bleeding edge. We have some really sharp technologists here. I don't know, you saw some of them around here hanging around showing their projects and products that they had.
Yeah.
They were showing that off this morning. And some of the presentations, it's run like a technical conference. There are technical papers that are published. There are proceedings going back 20 years that have every technical paper that's been published at the conference. And some of them are you know, simple antenna projects, and other of them are pretty deep physics. I mean, you're talking some pretty interesting physics getting tested and played with, let's put it that way.
Yeah, the frequencies that we're talking about, small dimensions make a big difference.
Huge difference. The distances that you work with for most of the stuff that we did here today, a quarter inch makes a huge difference.
Yeah. So now getting a little bit narrower, the specific event that you were running here is doing what?
Basically, this event is held every year to test antennas against a known set of standards. The folks either homebrew the antennas or they buy commercial antennas, and they want to know how well they're performing.
What parameters do you test?
Basically, we go in and we test the gain and directivity. And what we do is we actually measure the gain against a standard antenna. A known antenna that we've actually measured on a range that where everything is known, it's calculated, we know exactly how much gain it has. And we reference that against the antenna that's under test, which somebody brought in that they homebrewed or that they bought. And we've seen antennas here that are commercial antennas that have been up in the air for 20 years, and folks take them down, and the gain's not what it's expected because there's corrosion on them or there's, you know, it's deteriorated in some fashion. And it shows up very readily when you measure it here. And that's what we do, is we provide that service to them, because not everybody has the ability to perform this kind of a test at home.
Using some fancy test equipment, I guess?
It's semi-fancy. Basically, it's a spectrum analyzer with a tracking generator and a reference source antenna that we put downrange, you know, 100 feet or so, that provides a signal that we then use to receive on the test antenna. The folks that bring them in here, some of them have an idea how much gain their antenna has, some of them don't. And occasionally we tell them bad news. You know, you tell them the antenna's got 3 dB of gain and they say, no, it ought to be 9. I'm going, you look at the test equipment, you say, no, it's doing 3 dB.
Yeah. So do you get people who start modifying and repairing on site?
We've had antennas nearly rebuilt totally. I've had people take them home and then bring them to my house, and we set up a range in my driveway and retested them.
Yeah. So you're measuring gain. Any other parameters?
We basically measure directivity. One of the things that we test is we make sure that we're looking at the the main lobe of the antenna, that we're not seeing a reflection, that we're not seeing some extraneous signal that we're picking up on the test equipment. We want to make sure that we're looking at the specific antenna that's under test, and we do it both in the vertical plane and the horizontal plane.
Tilt it down. 64 is down 2 dB now. So
okay. Some of the guys were talking to you about something that surprised me, and that is that your sense antenna out there in the field, the thing that's receiving, was sitting almost on the ground.
Right.
I kind of expected it to be way up in the air trying to get away from reflections. Now, for the audience, 2 meters, 440 is subject to signals being bounced off of almost everything.
Anything and everything.
And if you wave your handy talkie around some distance from the repeater, you know what we're talking about. You see the signal peak and dip over just a few inches.
Mm-hmm.
So I was thinking you'd want to get way up as high as you could away from those reflections, and yet it was sitting on the ground.
Right. And 10, 15 years ago, we had a mast, and we would crank the antenna up to a measured amount, number of wavelengths above the ground, and we would take our measurements with that. The problem with that is you end up with a reflected wave that comes off the transmitting antenna downrange, hits the ground between you and it, and then back up into the antenna under test.
So you couldn't really get away from the reflections.
You really can't get away from it. And from event to event, year over year, it was in a different location. So you had different reflections, you had different conditions, everything was different. So it was very difficult to measure the same antenna year over year against the same reference. You got widely different results. So what we did was we decided we would lower the antenna to the ground to make it look like a point source. A point source is an infinitesimally small source, and any reflection is going to be very close to that antenna and be extraneous off to the side. And as here, if you would look at the scope while we were measuring, you could see as they moved the antenna, it was very smooth.
Okay, bring it up. Ooh, there you go. There's a sweet spot. Swing your left, right, see what it does.
So you weren't getting a bounce.
We weren't seeing a bounce. If there were a bounce coming back as you went across, you would see the reflection. You could pick it up.
Now, is this a technique that is widely known in the industry, or did you come across it and say, hey, this works better?
It's fairly widely known. The folks at the Central States VHF Conference have talked to me a couple, three times on the phone. We've exchanged information and talked about some things. I think they were the ones that more or less pioneered it. They went to lowering the antenna and trying to minimize the reflected wave. And we did the same thing about the same time they did without knowing about each other. And then as word got out, everybody
got the same results.
Everybody sort of got into the act, yeah.
So interesting, because I'd never heard about that. I haven't seen a banner headline in that VHF column. I don't read in QST, so
yeah.
Well, it's probably been there.
There have been a number of papers written about it. There are a couple of the folks at Central States who are very, very good at antenna engineering, and who have written some papers that are about reflected waves and how you optimize an antenna range and all that type of thing. But there, you're getting the antenna up in the air. And by taking it down to the ground, you've eliminated all that.
How high would you have to get away from reflections? Hundreds of feet?
You would have to get many wavelengths, several wavelengths.
Okay.
Up in the air.
So if your 2400 megahertz antennas, that's not so hard, but on 2 meters, it's going to...
On two meters, it has to be up, 12, 18 feet, or more to get up. And then the problem is as you go higher, you expose yourself to a wider area the horizon gets to be further away, so you start picking up more sources.
So you consider this technique to be technically valid?
Oh yes, it's we've been doing it for a number of years, 7 or 8 years now, and it seems to be consistent year over year. In the measurements, when we take the measurements, the smoothness of the lobe, the main lobe, from left to right and vertically in the vertical plane, indicates to us that there's nothing there that's interfering with that lobe. We're pretty much seeing the lobe as you would see it on a model. If you used EasyNeck and you model the antenna, mm-hmm. It's got a nice smooth lobe to it. It looks the same now on the scope. We had a couple of times at one of the conferences where we had a lot of shipping containers around us. And we had a, on 1296, we actually had a radar working at 12, near that frequency, that was about 3 miles away, running kilowatts and kilowatts. And you could actually see it on the scope.
You don't go back there for conferences, do you?
No, we don't go back there. But by getting away from the shipping containers, now we go out in a parking lot and just lay the antenna on the ground, as long as it's not grounded or shorted out, wet. You know, it could be shipping containers around and everything else, and there's just little or no reflection.
On asphalt or concrete, can you actually lay it on the ground?
Oh, yeah.
Because you're here on the grass, you're up a foot or 6 inches.
We put it up about a foot because the grass is wet.
Yeah.
I didn't want to disturb the feed point with something that was going to dry out over time or detune the antenna.
Yeah.
And you want to minimize the number of variables that you've got during a test.
So your generator puts out how much power?
A few milliwatts.
And it sweeps... Well, you can control how much it sweeps, but how much do you usually look at?
We typically look at about at 2 meters, as an example. We typically go 10 megahertz wide, so we go from 140 to 150 megahertz.
So you're also testing the bandwidth of the antenna.
Yes, we are. We can sit there, and we see a lot of antennas that come in that the gain isn't what the folks are looking for. It should be 9 dB. And we're only seeing 4 dB, you put the scope on it, and you find out the peak of the gain is off frequency. It's lower in frequency or higher in frequency than what we're measuring.
And so the antenna was probably adjusted for standing wave.
It was adjusted for standing wave, and it wasn't adjusted for frequency.
And standing wave and best radiation aren't necessarily the same thing.
Not necessarily.
In fact, most of the time, they're not the same thing at all.
And the other thing we ran into is the guy, the folks said that they built the antenna the way the article told them. And if you built it exactly the way the author said, you would probably get the same results. But in this case, they changed tubing diameters, or they changed mounting, or they did something, and they detuned the antenna. It performed the way it should on a different frequency.
I think you were telling somebody this little box is about $3,000.
You can get them today used for $2,000 to $3,000.
Yeah. So what I'm getting at is if someone wants to build their own antenna and test it and adjust it, they can't afford something like this. What can they do?
They can come to the conference.
Okay.
That's what we do.
That's about it.
That's what we're here for.
Yeah, it's hard or impossible to do just with whatever you might happen to have around your shack.
You could do it if you were around the shack if you had enough of the right equipment, but an SWR bridge is not it. An SWR bridge will only tell you how much reflected power you've got and at what frequency.
And you would think, well then, so it's if it's not being reflected, it must be being radiated, but
right.
Apparently not.
Well, what we run into here is some of the antennas get built, not so much at 2 meters, but at 432 and up, where the SWR curve is so broad, it covers the whole band. So they've got a 1.2 to 1 or a 1.1 to 1 SWR across the whole
dozens
420
to 100
band.
Megacycles.
But if they go to 150 or 152 megahertz, you know, the gain is probably 4 dB more, or maybe 6.
I just caught myself saying megacycles. I'm impressed. I'm old, clearly. As typical of most ham radio activities, what we got is a bunch of old men. Are we getting a replacement generation? Well, we're not getting a replacement generation in ham radio in general, but what about this little niche of it? How are we doing?
We're seeing some. We had a conference in Florida where the local high school brought some folks in, did a presentation on what they were doing with some satellite type thing, and they got very interested in what was going on. But being high school kids, they're in college now. You know, they have other interests at the moment.
Yeah,
but the
fumes.
The interest is still there from what I've heard. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens to those. We usually have a few young folk that come around that are curious as to what we're doing and why we're doing it. And if you take a 2300 or 2304 megahertz antenna and you show it to them, they're not impressed. But if you tell them that same antenna can be used on Wi-Fi at 2.4 gigahertz, that perks their interest.
And now we're not talking 100 feet, we're talking
no,
a few miles.
We're talking an antenna that's got a boom length of maybe 4 or 5 feet, 6 feet. And you're talking they could probably run Wi-Fi at least a mile, maybe more, And not only that, it narrows the antenna down so that only the people in the direction you're pointing can even see it.
Yeah.
And the people off to the side won't even know it's there. That intrigues some of them for some reason.
Yeah. And this area of technology is the future of RF. I mean, HF is contesting and DX and stuff is fun, but it's not the future of RF. RF is going up here and above.
Right. It's when cellular technology came out, the size of a cell that was used for cellular telephones was measured in miles. Now it's measured in feet. Or meters. It's not very big.
The real rural ones still aim for some distance, but in
some
cities.
Some of the very newest technology that works at 24 gigahertz up in there, it's measured literally in feet, and it's less than 100 feet, but it's got tremendous bandwidth. I mean, you're talking, instead of gigabit, you're talking 10 gigabit or even 100 gigabit connections.
Yeah. So where are they getting their engineers?
From here. The folks come here, give presentations, you talk to them. There are people out there working in the industry, locally here in the Southeast, that are working in that technology, that come here and share some of it once in a while. You know, tell us what they're doing and how they're doing it. Some of the technology is even available commercially.
Any of those guys hams?
Oh yes, oh yeah, several of them are. Not as many as used to be. Used to be, just about all the radio engineers of any stripe, you know, had a ham license because that's how they got started. And now most of them go to school, they go through college, they never touch a radio transmitter, all they know is what's in the computer, it does the engineering for them. And you know, that and a milling machine will get them something running at the tens of gigahertz range, and that's all they're interested in. And you see some of the stuff that gets brought in here, it's literally just a hole milled in a piece of brass that's resonant at 20, 30, 40 gigahertz. And
is that as fine-tuned as it could possibly be, or do they even care?
At that point, they're looking to put a broadband signal out for the most part. So the fine-tuning amounts to getting it to where it will talk. That's just all they care about.
They get their 100 or 200 feet, they're done.
With a good signal level, and that's all they care about.
All right. Is there anything that you would like to recommend to hams who have not done this little niche of ham radio?
The thing is, get on, if you've got a radio that's VHF capable, put up an antenna that's horizontally polarized. Most of the long distance work is done horizontally polarized as opposed to vertical, which is where repeaters work, during a VHF contest, and just listen. Find out what frequencies are being used in the contest and go listen. You'd be amazed at what's out there.
It is going to be on 6 meters, 50.1 to 50.3.
Somewhere in there, 144.1, 432.1, that type of thing. But it's
Those are frequencies that sound odd to FM operators' ears.
They are, but if you've got a radio that's capable, like one of the ICOMs or a Yaesu, you just dial it in and take a listen.
Now, speaking of FM operators, do you ever have to chase anybody away from the frequencies that are voluntarily planned for the sideband operation?
No, very, very seldom.
Ending up down there yet?
We have more problems with commercial interference than we do with hams getting down there. Mainly, there's no repeaters anywhere near them.
Well, looking for that secret simplex channel.
Once in a while, you get somebody that'll come down there and try something, but they get found out pretty quickly.
So stay above 144.5 for your secret simplex channel.
Take a look at the band plan and just stay up there and you'll be fine.
All right.
On contest weekend, that whole bottom end fills up.
The VHF contests are in early June?
There's a June, there's a fall one. There's some others that are scattered throughout the year. So you just have to keep up, go to your CQ or go to QST and look at the contest corral and it'll tell you when and where.
Yep. Not so much affected, except for 6 meters, by the sunspot cycle, right?
Very little.
Six has
some impact. 2 meters has some other, and 432 has some other interesting modes that the FM guys see every once in a while when the band will open up and they can hear repeaters from 100 miles away or 200 miles away.
You're talking about the tropospheric.
Tropo and other.
Now, has that changed at all over the time you've been playing with it?
No.
That's weather related, and it's
all weather related,
all atmosphere,
all that type of thing. Yes, and but it happens.
Go watch Gordon West on Ham Nation. He'll talk about it every third show.
But the The interesting thing is when the band opens up and you can hear a FM repeater that's a long ways away, a sideband operator has many dB advantage over FM, and he can talk a lot farther as long as the band is open. And these folks work up and down the East Coast easily. We've had we have one member here at the conference that holds the record at 5 gigahertz, talking from the East Coast of Florida to Texas, and on 5 gigahertz. And that's tropo. And so, you know, there's a lot of capability there if you just got the timing right.
Do you do any roving, any mountain topping?
I don't myself, no. We have some here that do.
And aside from roving, just ordinary operating, is there any mobile activity? Back when I was doing this, I had big wheel antenna on the back of a car and a Gonset sidewinder, and I never talked to anybody because there wasn't anybody to talk to, but I was set up for it. Not much mobile, and I never see halos or any 2-meter horizontal antennas anymore. So
they're around. You see, I saw a couple here pull in one of the vehicles. So, and mainly it's on the rovers. You know, they go out and
so just during the contests.
And well, some of them leave
them on special activities.
Yeah, some of them leave them on all the time because they're small enough. But some of the rover antenna setups are quite large, and I wouldn't want to be driving that vehicle with.
Right. Yeah. They don't. It's not just a halo on a mast on the back of the car. They set up something they got to stay still for a while.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you very much. Enjoy the conference.
Hey, been a pleasure.
Okay. Shut her down. So I am. Excited to see if David is still there.
I'm still here.
Wow.
I put you on mute so you didn't hear me sneeze or anything like that.
And actually, I muted you on this end, too. Yeah, you were double muted. No, our system CPU thing never got too high. So.
Oh, that's great.
We did good. So a couple of points to make here. Al, you did great. Al's the guy we interviewed. It was an ambush interview. He didn't know I was coming down to do that.
Oh, and it worked out really well.
Yeah, that's so he saw me wandering around shooting the B-roll. And by the way, I'm going to, on the YouTube version of the program, and which will show up on Facebook a little bit later, I'm going to add in most of the B-roll that I shot. You saw a little bit of it, but really just a little bit, as the guys were doing this contest stuff. So I will just stick it all in at the end, as you know, a little bit of an Easter egg, and the folks that tune out too early, sorry,
they're gonna miss it.
Gonna miss it.
There's some great looking antennas there.
Yeah, so Al did a great job. Again, he saw me shooting the B-roll as folks were doing stuff, and I think I asked him, you know, who'd be the best guy to talk to, and he hemmed and hawed a little bit, and I guess it's gonna be me, and because he runs the he runs the contest. That happens a lot in interviews. You know, hams are modest or mic shy or something. I think he was mic shy because he was holding that mic, you know, out here like this instead of up there like that. And that happens a lot too. So I was going to suggest if you've got one of these radios that will do the sideband stuff and you've never given it a try, you might have some fun.
Absolutely. Yeah. I was thinking about what I've got here on my my Elinco DX70 will do 6 meters.
Mm-hmm.
But that's as low as that one will go.
So you want to look at frequencies of 50.125 and 50.2, I think, are the calling and working frequencies. You know, we are sliding into sporadic E season again. Mm-hmm. It is centered around the solstice, the equinox. When the day and night are the same, which will peak toward the end of June. It's the day that we change from fall to summer, from spring to summer. But I've heard people start to talk about hearing some sporadic E's, and that will hit 10 meters, 15 meters, 6 meters, and occasionally it can hit 2 meters. I don't think anybody's heard any on 220, certainly not on 432, 450. But it's not unheard of on 2 meters, and that can carry a signal up to about 1,500 miles or so. It's the E layer, which is the lowest ionospheric layer that does anything useful. The D layer, which is lower, is the absorption layer. I don't understand all this stuff real well. It's sort of like I got a rudimentary idea of what it does, but not why. The E layer is a little bit above that, and can reflect higher frequency signals than the F layer does, but it's not available all that often, but it seems to gather around the equinoxes, stronger in the summer equinox than in the winter equinox. So look for that. 6 meters would be good.
We might try it out.
For the higher bands, well, for 6 meters when it's just local, and for the higher bands, there's not going to be a lot of activity. You're not going to run into people every day. It's going to be highly regional and local whether there's much activity, because these are fairly local frequencies. But you don't have to be one of the people that has the 100-foot tower and the kilowatt. If you've got, you know, the 706 or the Yaesu or the Kenwood, then do the best you can for an antenna. Their operation is all horizontal, and if all you've got is an FM vertical, you'll take a hit on signal strength. They say it's 20 dB. It could be about that. That's pretty significant. But if signals are reasonably strong anyway, then you'll make some contacts locally.
Or you'll at least be able to hear them, right? They may not be able to hear you.
Yeah, but they'll do the heavy lifting on their end. If you can manage a horizontal antenna of some kind, then it's going to help. There's probably, in most areas, going to be a net maybe once a week on 6 meters and 2 meters. So somebody should be advertising that, although we're pretty bad at good, up-to-date advertising of activities like that. And the VHF contests are, then you'll hear activity. You'll hear some on field day, and we'll have a VHF contest in early June. They tend to cluster the VHF contests, not too surprisingly, in the peak of sporadic e-season.
Right. I know that always comes up. I know a bunch of the guys in the Aries group and around here that participate in those, and they either rove or they go up on a big mountaintop and have got a lot of the older dedicated radios that do, you know, just 2 meters or just 70 centimeters.
Yeah. Nobody's making radios that do just that now. And as Al said, the radios, you know, these radios are not really awesome VHF, UHF radios, but they're not bad. They're plenty good for casual operating when, again, you're going to let the other guy with the big system do the hard work. But what those guys have done is they've fine-tuned their systems, their preamps, their feed lines, their antennas, down to the nth degree. And so they can do a really really good job of pulling stuff out, which is why maybe they'll hear you even though you don't hear them very well. Really hot receiver. If you get on during those contests are not like sweepstakes or field day. Activity is thin, and they will really appreciate you just dialing that 706 or that 857 down to 432.1 or 144.1 and calling the guys working the contest. Tune around a little bit. During the contest, they won't all sit on the exact dot one frequency. They'll appreciate your showing up.
Yeah.
So have you played with the sideband stuff?
You know, only at field day. You know, we usually do a 2 alpha or 3 alpha, and so one of the freebies there is you get a UHF, VHF, and several of the different operators will bring out that older gear, all the dedicated stuff, and a number of antennas. And so as long as we only have one of them on at a time, they'll do, you know, 6 meters, 2 meters, some 70 centimeters. And mostly those I watch over their shoulder, but they'll let other people get in and operate.
Yeah. And you've got the mountain ranges all around you. So that helps, because it is an incentive for people to get up there where all this stuff is line of sight.
Yep.
And getting up on a mountain is pretty cool. As long as you don't have another mountain 15 or 20 miles away to get in the way.
Right, other side of it. I've seen some cool pictures. There's some good, easy to get to Angeles National Forest. You can get up there and get really good, you know, majestic panoramas, you know, either to the south or the west or the east, just depending on where you are. And you don't have to hike that far. Some of them you can pull up and in your vehicle and just have a good view and put your mast up and do your thing. Yep. I've seen some cool pictures.
And across most of the country, this is also getting into tropo season. The weather patterns shift, and we get the high pressure centers that tend to extend the tropospheric version of VHF-UHF propagation, and that's pretty neat. You'll hear those on repeaters. Repeaters are coordinated for dead band conditions, 100 or so miles apart. You can't coordinate them for extended tropospheric conditions. Otherwise, we'd have three repeaters on the East Coast. We'd have one in New York, one in D.C., yeah, and one in Miami. And even under good conditions, they'd interfere with each other on any given frequency. So if you're pretty much an FM operator, what you're going to start hearing over much of the country, but particularly the East and West Coasts, is the repeaters from 300-400 miles away suddenly will become local repeaters. My buddy Jeff, AC4ZO, the very first time he turned on a 2-meter FM rig was one of the biggest band openings on the East Coast. And so he turned on the radio and every frequency was busy, and he was hearing from here in North Carolina, he was hearing stuff into Virginia, Maryland, Pennsylvania, New York State. And he thought, that was normal. That was the way things always were. And then the next day he turned his radio on and he thought it was busted because there wasn't anything.
It was dead.
It's a good story.
You should have called CQ on that FM repeater.
He should have called CQ. He would have dialed up some activity.
Yeah.
So I think that's it. Programs like that are why I say that Ham Radio Now is the most important amateur radio program on the internet, because you won't see that kind of thing on any other show like that. I don't think. Tell me which other show you've seen something like that on.
I have never seen anything like that on any other show.
That isn't the most expensive program I ever go to produce, because it's a drive down to Charlotte. It's 120 miles, and it's a hotel room for the night. But
did you shoot other material for other shows while you were there?
Not there, but I've still got some stuff left over from the local ham fest from a few weeks ago that I'm still working to get jammed through the system before Dayton. Cindy's wandering around the studio taking pictures of cats who are sitting on chairs around here. None of them are within camera range. I can give you let's see what I can do. Can I get,
there's the cat cam.
Stand up, Cindy.
Cindy doesn't want to be in. Cindy says, nope. I think I heard her say nope.
Yeah, she's hiding on the floor. All right, the camera's switched off. You can stand up now.
Very good. Well, I think this was great. And so I have to ask you before I got to run, how much time did it take you to put all that together?
Editing that story was probably about 6 to 8 hours worth, spread out over several days, because I put in 3-4 hours a day. Yeah. That's the other thing, getting down there and shooting it and then and editing it. If it's just the interview part, that's not that time consuming. That's just switching two cameras. And that was a 30-minute interview. It takes an hour or so to get things set up, the 30 minutes to switch it and some time to output it. That's not a big deal. What was the big deal was that I shot for 30, 45 minutes of that B-roll stuff. And then you have to know what you're going to do with that, what you've got, and then what you're going to do with it. So I have to watch it all and log it, make some notes so that I know what I've got. Then I go through the interview in every place that it seems like it would be appropriate to use some of the B-roll. Now that I know what it is, I'll slug it in and make the edit. Yeah. So that extends the edit out to several more hours.
You had some other good stuff in there, like you had the balloon.
Yeah. I was steal that
balloon,
stuff from
and
the
then
internet.
You found stuff about the balloon and articles and whatever.
Yeah.
So that's like balloon bounce is what they tried to do back then, right?
Yeah, and I looked at some stories about that. I didn't go in depth on it, but as I was looking for the pictures, I looked at some stories. And most of the stories mentioned that hams operated through it, but they don't give any detail, which is too bad because it would be fun to know what the hams really were able to do. But I can see if they were – and we're probably – take the guys who were set up for that long distance, kilowatt level signal to be able to bounce off of that in the, super tuned receivers. But that's what they did. So, compared to the commercial and government systems that were trying to get through it, they were probably running hundreds of kilowatts. So if the hams did it, they did something. And I just wish there was a little bit more documentation. And there may be. I just didn't come across it easily.
Just got to uncover it all.
Yep.
All right. Well, it was a good episode. So Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you.
Brought to you by you, the viewers and the audio listeners.
And that's right.
Wait a minute. I got to figure out where to.
I've been practicing this because I always get messed up. It's over here somewhere.
Yep.
Arvins.
Dueling Arvins.
Come on in, Gwen.
East Coast, West Coast Arvins. Is Gwen coming in? Will she sing the song?
She won't. Lila might, but Lila's going. Just a couple minutes and I'll take you to Girl Scouts. We're just wrapping up.
All right. So hamradionow.tv if you enjoy these programs and like to get us on the road. Dayton's going to be kind of expensive. I was watching Tom Medlin. He was on W5KUB.com, and he was doing his pitch, and I was listening to or watching Jason on Ham Radio 2.0, and he's doing his pitch. Everyone wants you to fund their trip to Dayton, and so do I. Hamradionow.tv.
Yeah.
So thanks, you guys. You are awesome for chipping in. And I will go now edit this stuff together and toss in that extra B-roll and get it on YouTube. Probably going to be by midday tomorrow. So you guys
are looking forward to it.
Guys on Facebook Live, you got a little extra bonus.
Yeah, we had a little Marty in the chat room.
Yeah, I'm not impressed with what I'm getting off of the Google Hangouts.
Yeah. Well, it was worth trying out. It didn't crash. So,
yeah, and it wouldn't freeze. I've seen other people get really good pictures off of Google Hangouts. So I'm kind of wondering, you know, if I'm gonna
do some wiring here and see if I go right to my router because I'm going through a switch and make sure the Wi-Fi's off because I'm worried that I'm still partly on some of the Wi-Fi.
Yeah, but if you've got quality of service through Wi-Fi could be a thing.
Yeah.
But if you've got more than a couple of megabits. That's all this video uses, 2 or 3 megabits best. Yep. And I kind of wondered, you know, have I got something set wrong? I tried to go through my router's quality of service and tell it pay most attention to things like Skype and video. Mm-hmm. But it's because it's bad on Skype and no one else is complaining about Skype the way I am.
Yeah.
And Hangouts has looked better from just about everybody else I've looked. I mean, right now it looks pretty good. But mm-hmm. You know, it's coming and going.
It's in and out. It's in and out. It's in and out. You look really good. I know that what's coming back to me doesn't look so great.
Yeah. So I wonder if I've got something on my incoming end that is limiting my ability to get good stuff from other people. When I've set up 3 cameras in here though, if I set up a single camera or a single computer running Skype and just one-to-one connection, what I send and what I get back are about the same, about, you know, 2.5-3 megabits. Mm-hmm. That seems to work. They add another layer, a second computer, and it drops very low and does all that freezing stuff on Skype anyway. So if anybody out there has experience with this and wants to tell me what I'm doing wrong, if I'm doing something wrong or something I could try, that should be enticing because hams love telling you what to try
there
to
make
something better.
I'll even do some research and looking around.
All right.
So I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
He's getting good at this. He knows how to make the show end. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, on the most important amateur radio program on the internet, Ham Radio Now. Over.
And out. 7-3.
So somebody help me out.
If it doesn't rain, yes, we have all kinds of parking.
I got it.
But if it rains, caretaker of the track says there will be no parking riding on that track.
Interesting, when you put your hand there, you put a notch in there from the response of the antenna.
So,
that's right.
What they had to do was calculate just how many cars are parking.
We ought to have a detouring contest.
And they have an owner parking up in the station. And so that's only like 300 some cars in the staging area that they can accommodate if it rains and you can't work in a race.
Really?
That's what limits how much curves are on the track. So that's why we're limited on 3 cars.
What we need is hex drivers with those 5/8 head. Got it?
Yeah, everybody wants to stay on the park.
They have to regrade it.
It is not a solid track. The horses have to have some boosters.
The University of Connecticut.
So it's not a hard pack track anyway. Dirt track, car racing. So it is solid, but it's in nature. So any kind of rain out there, you can sink down 6 inches even. Just moist rain. So I don't know what
to do. Well, it'll be frustrating if we want you guys to have spaces so they can park their car. But you're saying you can't come and go. Can they come and go once a day or not?
Yeah, you can.
Like before a certain time.
Stay up there for a minute.
Okay, hold on. That's the right angle.
That's why we're going to go up Thursday. I'm going to go up the whole week, and I have to pick up our trailer Thursday afternoon. Take it in. The guys, whoever wants to store stuff in there.
The last day, they're the same.
Your K4 SPC?
SQC.
SQC.
I can't hold the antenna.
One guy needs to bring it.
And
it's just
that
they were selling
for
$20
and I checked it out. There you go.
Okay.
It's on there.
I'll do that.
I got a small ammo box that I put
on. Do we have another adapter in the BNC?
Now,
how did we get that before?
There's one.
I have an adapter.
It's not in the
bucket. It's not user-friendly.
No, there's a double female here.
The adapter's on the other antenna.
Oh. An adapter and you have it
here. He's got one.
Okay.
Yeah, that's kind of pulling it down.
I guess I need to
lock
it.
We can push it up once
sit down
we get
and
it
make
connected
watch
up.
Cable.
I've got a whole kit in my car.
Here you go.
You got it? Why don't you tip her up and down a bit, see if we can improve on it.
They're down.
Okay, bring it up. Ooh, there you go. There's a sweet spot. Swing your left, right, see what it does.
Dropping off.
A little bit. It's pretty broad. Yeah, it's down about 3/10, 4/10, 5/10.
Okay, that should be peaked there. I'll go to the other side, see if it's got any square. Drop one off there.
Yeah, 2/10 down. Yeah,
that
yeah.
Be peaked up
a DB again. Down there, and now you're back. 1/6.
All right, you got it?
Got it.
If you need an adapter.
Oh. One of those, a Pasternak or, oh yeah. My God, look at that.
Let me know.
Holy cow. Where'd you get that?
MCM Electronics.
Oh, MCM. Yeah. That's their version, huh?
That's their version. I think it was like
7 hours. Got to see what it is. Yeah.
Is this commercial?
Commercial.
Yep.
Shaking.
Those are really down. It looks like they're
weak. Make sure I know.
Okay, move it up down.
Right.
Oh, yeah, down the DB. Okay, down a little bit.
The other way?
Took him away.
Yeah, the other way to the left.
Yeah, he was pressing it.
Right about there.
So,
had
8.
Got it. Try 8.
Last year, he could.
If you want to know the actual game before I publish it, I got the spreadsheets on my laptop.
Oh,
Okay.
So it's not, I just need to plug them in.
When I'm on vacation somewhere, I hook up an HT to the satellite.
You just say yes, ma'am. Yeah.
My satellite. And that's why mine will turn sideways.
So you and
that's the L, it's the
And that one's commercial too, right?
Yeah. 20 dB gain.
That is a broadband antenna. It's flat.
Was it pretty? Was it narrower? So you said
the nose this way was narrow.
Okay, this way.
This way, not so much. But the gain bandwidth on that thing, I got this thing set 40 megahertz, and it's like.
Yep.
He brought his own
design that started about 40 years ago. I finally built it, so it'll stay up. The coax went 8.5 dB measure. So you could just hook, I don't know how your system's set up, but just add 0.85.
Don't lose the adapter.
Are you doing the 1296 lighter?
In about a few minutes.
That's tight enough.
I think this is the last 432. I don't. Anybody got 900? Probably not.
You just put it in there. Some sort of barrel. You got a barrel there.
I got one right there.
Oh, okay.
That's one thing I didn't bring.
That's all right, we got it.
Yeah. She hope I tweaked it, but it'll be good enough. It is.
Did it even show up?
See, this is one that the game changes dramatic.
Game should peak around.
Well, look at the dips in
it. 32.5. Well, that's long. You want me to wiggle it around a little bit?
Let's let it settle down a minute there.
Where's start?
The marker's at 432.1.
Yeah.
But above the frequency, the top end is 455.
Yeah.
So at about 453, you got a notch in it, and you got another one at like 436 or so.
Yeah.
And how many elements?
15. That's what it is, right?
And what's your call?
WB7PMP.
7PM.
Whiskey Bravo 7. Papa Mike Papa.
Okay, and your name?
Ron Barrett.
There's a back entrance, too.
You know, dB over a dipole, you're talking 13.
What are you doing to compensate for reflections?
We're putting the sense antenna, the source antenna, as low to the ground as we can.
Yeah.
So.
Thank you.
thing. Basically, you want to know why you want to make a great decision.
I'm sterile now?
Here you go.
Yep. Make sure I got the marker set right. I'd hate to be lying to people with the wrong marker.
Yeah, 1296-100.
Yep. There it is. Okay. Yeah, it looks like you're pretty much take her up down, see if it makes any difference.
Yeah. That's down a little bit.
Oh, yeah, Chris.
Half a dB.
Last time I stopped talking to it,
go back up, make sure it drops off. So we're
just okay.
Is
that dropping off?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, left, right should be good. That's the sight down the boom.
58.6.
All right. I will hold this up to keep the weight off the back for you. You don't have to set it on there as long as you're real close.
Yeah.
Man.
All right, bring it around this way a little bit. All right. What about there? Yeah, don't have the elements. If you can, go just a tad higher because it'll detune being close to that metal pipe.
There you go. Made about half a dB.
That peaked right there?
I have a reading. Why don't you tilt it? There's 60.3. Tilt it.
All right, there's down.
Yeah, you're dropping off.
Okay. That should be back dead on.
Yeah.
All right, there's up.
Yeah, you're down a dB. Okay.
Right about there should be it.
And left, right, just to see, make sure we're on the beam.
How much is it dropping off there? I'm curious of the pattern of this thing.
There's 67, about 6 dB.
Okay. Got good pattern, then. It'd be interesting to see how bumpy it is. I think it's an MDS design.
That's another 67, yeah.
Okay. So 6 dB off, probably 10 or 15 degrees.
Yeah, that sucker's got a needle nose on it. You better have a good rotator. And it better not be windy. You're like flopping in the breeze, you'd know it. 62.3.
All right.
Why don't you come here and sign it in?
Okay.
I ain't going to count the elements. You're going to.
Where's Ben?
Hell, this is Ben's K4QF, and it is.
See, been low, right?
24 elements, yep. K4QF.
Huh. Okay.
Stick them.
Are you about to leave? Okay.
Difference between the measured antenna and the
you got a reading?
I do.
Ready?
Why don't you tilt it down? Mm-hmm. 64 is down 2 dB now. So
okay. There's back up. Should be about the same drop.
Yeah, it's down. Yeah. 2.5 dB. Yeah.
All right. Right about there should be peaked again.
Yeah. 62.5. Yeah.
All right.
Do it left, right. 62.4. There's where you were.
Yeah. Yep.
There you're dropping off.
Okay. Here's the other side, about the same amount.
Yeah, about 500 difference. Put her back on. Let's see if we come back with the same maiden.
That should be the peak right about there.
62.4.
Got it?
Yep.
It took us forever to figure that out.
Why is it?
2304. What do we got? Oh, we
have one. Yep.
Yeah. It's just a small quad. Or they could just be, you could just cut them all up and fold them.
Is that a homebrew?
Yeah.
What's the advantage?
Well, I, you know, I've seen these, you know, plans for these things, you know, online.
And only one.
Yeah, it looks just like the directive.
I got it. Thank you.
Not a problem.
Bruce need any help in there?
He's good. There was nobody in line, and Paul Trotter was helping him. But when I went, there was no one in the line. So.
If it goes to Radio Shack in the next week or so, you can get these things here. They're worth $20, and 80% off, you give them about $4.
And do we sweep around the reference?
Yeah, we do that. Get her pointed down there, down range.
That's pretty good. You ready?
Yeah, tilt her down. It's getting better. Go down further. Getting better. Tilt her down further. There you dropped off. Bring her back up. Bring her back up.
Yeah, little up and rider. That's good.
Take, he's got something underneath the... There you go.
Yeah, I have one.
Yeah, I was driving in there. They had this thing for 8% off.
Left and right?
No.
But I hear
how they're going out. They're going out of business. Pretty good. Okay, left and right.
I've never mobile.
I lost you. This is a 2304.
I don't have an HF antenna on my vehicle.
Yeah, you're down 4 dB.
Let me go. Park.
Okay. Yeah, you're down 5 dB now.
Yeah, we're good.
Got her settled down. Now you're 3 dB down. You must be to the right.
Yeah.
There you go. Yeah. 7.6, that's right where she fits you. Okay.
Good. Well, I usually work that from home.
Big time.
Off of the mountain. I was in. Sitting inside of a 4x8.
You got to pay attention. We'll move on. You know how we are.
And then I got inside the truck.
You can't keep up taking this.
Wow. Got this broken wood to get inside the truck. The lightning was dancing. Yeah, I was in the car.
Pretty low.
Yeah, I did that on wrong map.
Well, you're pointed off the side, aren't you?
That's
20 dB down from the reference. 15 dB down from the reference.
Some problem with the feet or something?
I may need to clean that feet. Yeah,
well, let me do this again.
Well, make sure I've had some come up like that.
Plate of grass or something.
I got this bag of something I got from the road. Let's check this out too.
It's sitting, so.
does any better.
How many elements are that?
44.
Another 44. Commercial. Nah, it's still reading. Almost 20 dB down.
Okay, hold on.
It's almost
not,
like it's
you're not
there.
Very good. Okay, you're not pointing very good. You need to point back this way. Hold on, we're a little off polarization. Straighten it up.
Still not?
Still not. That's. Might be easier to point it if you bring it down to your head height, just till we can get ascertained.
Yeah, there you go. Just hold it. Hold it down a little lower and I'll line it up like a gun. Okay, that's right on it.
Yeah, see,
that's still down?
It's 12 dB down.
All right, let me clean the center conductor on this one here. I think that's what part of the problem is. The center conductor on this SMA is pretty nasty. Let's see if I've got something like that.
How am I supposed to point this? Like that?
I would, yeah, it's...
Look at the... Yeah, there's two different ways here, so that would be horizontal and the other way would be vertical.
Like that?
That's horizontal.
What would you call that thing? Double diamond?
A paint can lid. Coffee can lid.
Quad loop?
You want me to hold that for you?
I don't have my little wire brush with me.
Just move over a little bit.
There you go.
Okay, you got her pointed off that direction?
I think so.
Okay, rotate it 90 degrees.
There's no brakes.
Okay, 90 degrees.
That's
3 dB. Peak is...
Had this thing up in the air. Probably didn't end up in the air for probably
about... Okay. Finished?
Rotate it back 90 degrees
when,
again.
When they were doing the AL-40 stuff, is when I had this thing up in the air, and then of course, 40 went down, and I had to take everything down. So.
Okay, just point it straight at it and hold it.
Back and forth several times, see if it makes any difference.
3 dB difference. It's stable, I mean, it's 3 dB.
Okay, that's right on it.
Any better?
It's a little better, but it's still...
I've never looked down. Line it up.
Yeah, of course, you were probably starting out
with 48.5 is about 10 dB less than the reference. That's okay.
Yeah, but I have had this on the rough I've never missed.
Okay, I got that one. Tilt it down a little bit. See how it is. Oh, yeah, it drops off. Take it up. Tilt it up. There you go. That's about, there's 3 dB. Yeah. Put her back on, then go left, right.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, you're down 5 dB.
Okay. Left.
Okay. Yeah, you're about 4 dB. Okay, put her back on, and let me get a reading.
Okay, that's right on the middle.
Tilt it down a little bit. There you go. Okay.
Good.
We feel.
6.8 dB, put it back vertical.
It should be loose.
I bought it.
Okay, we got it. What would you call it?
Is it has essentially zero gain.
That's to be expected.
And that's to be expected, but it's broad as a barn door as far as pattern is concerned. You know, you've got going around as you rotated it this way, I could see, you know, 3/10, 4/10.
That's what the intent was.
Right.
Omnidirectional
antenna. And it's basically, as you come around right in here, it's down about 3/10 dB, which is nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it's essentially omnidirectional. The pattern is like a bowl you put over. I mean, there's just,
so the pattern is what it should be.
Yeah, it's right on the money for what you would expect.
Okay.
For that design.
The problem is now that it's more resonant at 1400 than it is at 1296.
Yeah, I could widen this thing out and we could look at to see if there is a resonant point.
Could you?
Sure. Okay. I can tell you. Yeah, 1.8 ain't far enough.
1.8 ain't far enough.
It's
how did I miss it that far?
You need to calibrate that metric ruler.
Huh?
So you need to calibrate that metric ruler.
So our next step is to,
you want to look at it?
I take your word for it. Where is it resonant?
Let me move the marker.
I see it's got a definite peak.
It's got, I mean, it's an amazing peak. Starts at 1.71 and goes to about 1.9. 1.7 to 1.9. So it's 1700 to 1900. But it's like this. And that may be a factor of the feed line. The feed point.
I didn't think about that.
Yeah.